Thanks so much for the invitation to be here. I'm really a newbie in prefrontal cortex, so it's incredibly helpful, and I've learned a lot from the last day. So I hope that this talk is going to intersect actually with lots of things that have been talked about, particularly this morning. Just to say that I'm sort of representing a big team, which includes Xiaojing and his lab, Beth Buffalo, Dave Freeman, Bob Knight, and Jack Lin, our experimental collaborators, in a project that's funded through the Brain Initiative on learning to learn. You know, what are the mechanisms by which abstract representations get built into brains, and can we reveal circuit mechanisms by comparing humans and non-human primates. So the task I'm going to talk about is one that comes from very early in this project, but is still quite, you know, revealing lots of rich stuff, and we're still really in the middle of the data analysis. So I took this workshop idea seriously. None of this is published, so don't expect it to be too baked. So we've been working with the Wisconsin card sorting test, which is a classic behavioral task that's often used in humans to probe cognitive flexibility. And unlike many of the tasks that you heard about this morning, it's a task, a rule switching task, but one that is uncued, right? So what the animal sees or the human, these four different cards, and one feature of the card at any time is rewarded, but the animal is not told which one. And so by trial and error, you have to figure out the rule, right, for what is the rewarded card at any time. And that goes on until you get most of them right, and then the rule switches without you being told about it. And so the way that's been implemented for the monkeys who have been trained to do this successfully is that they fixate for 500 milliseconds, they do a self-paced search, right? They can look anywhere they want. And then to indicate their choice, they hold fixation on their choice for 800 milliseconds, after which point they get rewarded or they are punished with a timeout. So we do this both in monkeys and humans. Our human collaborators are working with patients in the hospital. And so we have considerable amount of data also from humans, single unit recordings that I won't be able to talk about today. But we are able to at least compare the behavior of humans and monkeys. And as we heard about from other tasks from Stan and others, monkeys are much worse at this kind of thing than humans. They can certainly do the task, but they take many more trials. So the number of trials to learn the rule in this case is at least a factor of 3 to 5 more than humans take. So the first challenge is to model this kind of behavior. And there's a long, rich literature on modeling exactly this kind of task, right? Where one might like to, because it's sort of a classic reinforcement learning or inference problem, one might postulate a kind of model whereby internally you have some set of beliefs over which rule might be operative at any time. Models by, you know, these group of people here have postulated different kinds of ways to update that rule, right? So given those belief states, you update them, given the input that you take, your choices, the feedback, and then you select the next exemplar given that updated belief system. So that's a lovely way to model this data, but it has the disadvantage that it you have to kind of set up, right, an algorithm that might be operative. And if one doesn't want to do that, right, if we want to instead just query the behavior as to what might be going on in terms of how long, you know, memory lasts, what might be the structure of the belief state, we might want to apply a more agnostic technique and just go purely from the kind of statistics of the behavior to learn what those rule updates are. And so that is what Vishwa Gudar and Brian Kim, who are working with Xiaojing, did. And they implemented a model that we heard a little bit about from Marieka, I think, this morning, a GLM-type model. And so this is a sort of extension of the kind of HMM-GLM you heard about today, whereby the model doesn't just take into account measurements that you're making of the animal. It takes into account also inputs. So it's an input-output HMM-GLM, where you learn a set of states that kind of compress the description of the choices and the behavior, and you also learn a transition matrix between those states.
And so what we're doing in this case, unlike this morning, we don't take into account any physiological variables. We purely look at the behavior. So we know what the set of cards that the animal saw were. We know what it did. And so we take that set of choices, and for every feature, we maintain a record, right? We make a separate model for the update of every feature and the response given to that feature. And the response is framed as a one-hop matrix where, say, this was the feature that was the card that was chosen. Every feature on the chosen card will be given a response vector that has a one, right, in the chosen, C is chosen, and plus if it got it right. And if that card was chosen and it got it wrong, every feature on that card will get a C minus. And all the features on all the other cards were not chosen, and they also carry with them the response, you know, the plus or minus that occurred on that trial. And so given this input, right, the experiences and the outputs, one crunches that, right, through the model and determines the number of states. And it turns out that the best model that's most robust to overfitting finds four states, and it uses the current time and the previous time. So it looks back in time by one state. And those four states turn out to align with choice probabilities, right? So we can think about them as a state in which the animal persists. It continues to choose the same feature. It prefers that feature, so it chooses it more often than chance. Or it randomly is in a state where it's randomly selecting that feature, or it's actually actively avoiding it. And the avoid state is needed in this case because we've taken each of the features to be updated independently. If you remember the card setup, if you say have a card that's yellow, you can only if each color appears once on one of the cards. And so all the other colors will be necessarily not chosen, right? So the avoid state is a way to kind of mop up that actual true lack of independence in the task setup. All right, so how does that look when we fit a model like this to human behavior and to monkey behavior? So here you're just seeing the color, right? The state that each of the features are in as the trial unfolds. And so what you'll see by eye straight away is that humans fluctuate, right, between those states much more frequently. Monkeys kind of perseverate in a given behavior for much longer. And we can now use this model to do things like extract the state transitions. I'm not going to dive into those too much, but you know, we see sort of similar structure. What is also lovely about this model, it gives us the opportunity to also assess what the animal is doing with the not chosen features, right? So all the features that weren't on the chosen card, their state is also being updated from trial to trial, but given the feedback vector that I showed you earlier. And so there are two really types of feedback. There's direct feedback, that is feedback about the feature that's chosen, and indirect feedback, whereby you're getting information about the features that weren't chosen. Right? If you get a correct on the one that is chosen, that's essentially an incorrect on all the cards that weren't chosen. And so this lets us sort of evaluate whether subjects are able to kind of keep track of that sort of indirect data as well. So how do monkeys and humans compare? So here's an example of how many features are explored per block. And what you're seeing in the tan color in monkeys and green is humans. And so humans tend to explore more features per block. The number of trials that they spend exploring a given feature, you saw already in those plots earlier that. So number of trials exploring a feature is much larger for monkeys. We already kind of saw that in the data. And we can also evaluate sort of how many features are sort of being explored simultaneously, right? What to how many features is that feedback kind of essentially adding information? And that tends to be more than one, you know, and kind of comparable actually between humans and monkeys. So how are monkeys different? As we've already heard today, they're noisier, they're stubborn, and they neglect negative feedback. So we can see that from the model behavior, because if we compare humans with monkeys in terms of their probability of choosing an unexplored feature, so a feature that's not currently kind of in the set of hypotheses, monkeys will kind of randomly choose unexplored features much more often than humans will. they also perseverate for much longer. So the probability of continuing to use a rule after the rule has switched is much longer for monkeys. The way that they use indirect feedback, you see that the monkeys here are barely using it at all. So the change in choice probability, taking into account indirect feedback, is not changed at all pretty much for monkeys, whereas humans are using that information quite effectively. And finally, the probability of continuing to explore a feature after getting negative feedback about it is really high for monkeys, whereas for humans, it's very low. And so this model allows us to kind of probe these details of the behavior. So it's a kind of, I think, powerful way of looking at the data, because it's a kind of model agnostic or algorithm agnostic way of evaluating what they're doing without kind of imposing a behavioral strategy upon them. It lets us see which features are being attended to, lets us sort of evaluate the cognitive capacity, right? How many features are kind of in the hypothesis mix, lets us see how ambiguous feedback is handled, and lets us dissect kind of these core differences between human and monkey behavior. And just to point out that this preprint is on the bioarchive if you guys would like to have a look at it. All right, so that's model fitting. Where I will go now is show you what we've been getting out of analysis of neural data from monkeys while they're doing this task. And this is in collaboration with Beth Buffalo. Beth's lab have been using gray drives. So they have drives that allow one to put electrodes deeply into the brain. This monkey was recorded from two gray drives simultaneously. And so there are recordings from many locations throughout the brain, about 200 electrodes throughout the brain, which are sort of mainly focusing on hippocampus, some prefrontal cortex, but other areas as well. And so this analysis I'll be talking about is done by graduate students and in my lab, and also Mike Jutras from Beth's lab. So what have we been learning? Some things that also align with some of the things that we've been hearing about today. So first, what we tried, well, not first, what we last tried, because we've only had the spikes very recently, but what I'll first tell you about is what we get directly by looking at the spiking data, right? So from these about 200 electrodes, we get about 60 well-isolated units. And so we can do some classical sort of decoding to look at what information is encoded in that population. And so the way I'll be presenting these decoding measures to you is in terms of the weights of the decoder. So we train a different decoder at every slice in time on the spiking activity. And these are the weights that you're seeing here, and they're sort of organized by brain area. And then we look at the net decoding ability, right, of this population. And here what I'm showing you is the decoding of the animal's choice, right? So here's the moment of feedback, and we see the choice is represented in that activity in the fixation period prior to feedback, and also for some period extending out into the time of feedback. What we particularly wanted to look at is an issue that also got discussed this morning and yesterday by Vim and by Andreas, is sort of what features, or you know, what sensory features of the stimulus can we see being encoded directly in this spiking data. So we asked, can we decode, say, the color, right, of the selected cod? And indeed you can, you know, well above choice chance, and that weirdly sort of turns out to be encoded primarily in the hippocampal neurons. We can look for shape. That is also quite strongly decodable. And those units tend to be in prefrontal cortex. We can ask about the pattern, right? So that's the other feature, the texture on the cod. And again, it's also quite well decodable down here in hippocampus, parietal, and also a little bit in prefrontal cortex. So this sort of distributed representation all across the brain of the visual elements that define the cod. What we were hoping to see that over time, as the rule, it gets learned by the animal over the course of the block, one might expect that those visual features become less well decoded, or you know, it may be the one that the rule is based on becomes more strongly decoded at the expense of the others. So far, we haven't been able to see anything like that. In fact, we haven't been able to find direct evidence, as almost everyone showed us today, these beautiful responses from Anne and from others of rule decoding. That's possibly because this is a very high dimensional space, right? We have 12 rules. We have kind of free behavior. It's just hard to find. So hopefully sometime I'll be able to tell you how we can see that. But for the time being, we haven't been able to extract that directly. So just to put those all together on one plot, just to show you how strongly they're all there. So these are the three sensory features, and this is the ultimate choice, which is some, the weights here are of the choice decoder, and you can see that's quite distributed all over the place between prefrontal and hippocampus as well. So that's what we've done so far with the spiking data. We've done a lot more analysis of the LFP. And so here's decoding of choice from the LFP data and looking here at three different frequency bands at 4 to 5 hertz, 10 to 13 hertz, and 20 to 24 hertz. And the strongest decodability of choice so far that we're seeing is in that low frequency band. And here that appears to kind of primarily live in hippocampus. Jumping over that. One of the very strongest signals, as probably everyone knows, is feedback, right? So at the time that the animal gets the feedback, there's very strong and different signals for positive and negative feedback. And that's here, that's how well we can decode it from the spikes, but I'm going to really focus on decoding it and what we can find out about it from the LFP. For now on, just for the time being, I'll be focusing on the 25 to 35 hertz frequency band. So what we did was we asked about, we just did an ICA analysis to find out what subnetworks are acting together. There's quite a lot of coordinated activity in the LFP and that's quite widely distributed. And so when we do ICA, we find 8 modes, and I'm just going to show you 4 of them that are particularly interesting. And so what you're seeing here is the shape of those modes. So here are the weights distributed across the brain. They're kind of two of them in prefrontal cortex, one in hippocampus, and another one in a kind of subregion of hippocampus. And what I'm showing you is the time course of those modes for correct and incorrect trials. And so you see that that those activity patterns, at least for these three, separate quite well for correct and incorrect feedback. And here's stacking them up. So the blue is a correct response and the red is an incorrect response. And you see that hippocampus responds rapidly to a correct response, and you only see that response later in prefrontal cortex, whereas the incorrect response is sort of synchronous actually with the, occurs at the same time in prefrontal cortex. In this, another mode here in prefrontal cortex at which you get this kind of delayed response as well about the negative feedback. So what we would like to see is if there's any evidence for modulation by the states that I showed you in our behavioral data, right? So we analyze the data. We know it's sometimes the animal is in a kind of exploit mode. Other times it's in a explore mode. We divided that more finely into 4 states. For now, let's just block it into explore and exploit, and have a look at what happens to these modes when we split up these feedback modes by the behavioral state. So there was this one that I showed you. This is sort of a strange oscillation that occurs during fixation that's there in hippocampus. That's not, maybe a little bit modulated by correct feedback to come, which is a little bit strange. Don't really know what to interpret of that. It's probably finite size. I'm not sure it's significant. So we wouldn't expect to see any modulation in that, and there isn't much, so that's good. When we look at these other modes, though, we do see significant modulation by whether or not the animal's in this sort of explore or exploit condition. And so here we get an increased, so the lighter color is the exploit, sorry, is the explore, and here also the, is that the right way around? Huh. I think the lighter color here is the explore, and also here the explore. Right. So both of those modes are affected in their amplitude by the state, the explore exploit state the animal's in. But this is the one that I think is the most interesting, which is that we see the appearance of this kind of early component in the exploit case, in the explore case. So when the animal is moving into an explore mode, we find that there's this sort of response during the positive feedback condition in which there's sort of an extra signal, which is really very tight up against the time of the feedback. That occurs in this longer one as well. So this is the one where the incorrect has this second mode, but we also see this appearance of an early signal relative to in the case of the explore modes. This seems maybe potentially reminiscent of work from Etienne Coughlin's lab, where he showed that when animals are kind of in, he classifies states into a sort of switch or stay condition. I think there's people actually. And so what they saw was that there was a signal prior to the onset of the feedback during these switch states in which the animal was making, person was making a decision to switch from exploiting a rule back to explore. So maybe our early mode is some reflection of that. The way Etienne's group have interpreted that is that it's sort of a flag to pay particular attention to later feedback. You know, maybe puts prefrontal cortex into a sort of a more learning state that may be able to make different use, right, of the feedback later. All right, so just one last thing I want to show you. This is still very, very, as I say, half-baked. So we also see some evidence that that LFP carries information about kind of search strategies, right? So that's something about this task that's a little bit different from the tasks that you've heard about today, is that while the animal is deciding, it can move its eyes, right, in lots of different ways around these four cards. And what we find is that the statistics of those saccade movements, sorry for the very small graph, but the statistics of those saccade movements are one thing that kind of changes systematically as the animal gets deeper into the trial and starts to learn the rule better and better. And so, you know, squinting, you might be able to see that very short trials, the number of very short trials increases, that's this orange one and blue one, while the number of very long, you know, search paths decreases. And that's something that happens quite systematically. And then if we look at the LFP in the 4 to 5 hertz bands, we can see that there seems to be activity. So this is looking prior to the beginning of the entire saccade sequence. You can even see by eye, this is separated by what the animal subsequently does, whether it goes directly to the choice or whether it, you know, makes 5 saccades on the way there. This activity prior to the onset of movement during the fixation time is actually not bad at predicting what search strategy the animal will subsequently do. Okay, that's what I've got. So what I've shown you is a parallel behavioral modeling and analysis of brainwide activity during flexible decision-making. I've shown you activity in monkeys. We do have humans, but we are hoping, you know, human data is very small data. This is a complicated problem. So what we're hoping is that what we learn from our analysis of the monkey data is going to target us and help us to more sharply ask good questions in the human data. We certainly see differential feedback responses that are very globally distributed across the brain. This gives us a route to look for these finer timescale differences that we see in the monkeys. We find that there's information in that activity about stimulus features, and we can decode the choice. But so far, we don't see a clear representation of the rule, nor do we see anything that really correlates with the gradual learning of the rule across the course of the trial. We find these distributed networks for feedback that differently represent positive and negative feedback. And we start to see evidence for explore and exploit differences in networks in prefrontal cortex and hippocampus that maybe align with the states that we find from our statistical analysis of behavior. I also just showed you intriguing hints of predictability of saccade strategy from the pre-saccade LFP. All right, so still open, the representation of abstraction, right? How are these rules, if they are represented in cortex? What can we, how can we see, right, the time scale, the time costs of inference? I guess from models by Xiaojing's lab and others, what one might hope to see is a high dimensional visual stimulus getting kind of crunched down onto some attractor, right, that represents that rule. We would love to find direct evidence for that. And we're still looking, you know, just trying to find the right way to look at the data in order to reveal that structure. And ultimately, we'd love to have a detailed monkey and human comparison from the neural data. And finally, link to computation. Hopefully, this is a kind of introduction for Xiaojing. You know, so given all of this cool stuff, coding kind of information that we see in data, all of us, right? How do we tie that ultimately to the algorithms that the animal, the brain, is using to do the computations that are being represented here? And so what we need to do that are our models that are mechanistic, and we need to understand, right, how to link our data with those mechanistic models. All right, I'll stop here with thanks to all the collaborators, you know, lovely work from Fisher and Brian and guys from my lab and my collaborators. So thank you.